We're going to go through the basics. As we do this, we're going to talk. I really, really want you guys to be working with me here and give me examples, because honestly, for the first time in a long time, I had a topical teaching, and I was like, you could talk about devotionals for years. There's so much that's out there. People have different opinions how they do it. I've seen different examples. It's really hard to pinpoint and kind of narrow it down, so I did the best that I could in coming up with broad topics that we can work through, but yeah, I need you to be with me. So, basic doing devotional. The first step is that you need to know why you're doing a devotional. What is the purpose? And you need to establish this kind of early on, okay? So ask yourself these questions. Why are you writing this devotional? And what do you hope to accomplish? Okay. There's different types of devotionals. When you hear the word devotional, what do you think?
Small group.
You think small group?
A small group of people.
Yep, okay. Small group of people, good audience. Any other type of devotionals you've heard that word used? If I'm going to go do a devo, what
are my devos?
Personal devos.
I think of, like, in the beginning of a seminar or something, to bring focus to something.
Awesome. Yeah. It's a good thing to help focus. It's a word from the Lord that's helping people focus in. I think of those books, I mean, devotionals and devotional classics that people have imprinted out of their own personal devotional times that they're now sharing with people. Mm-hmm. Okay, so what is a devotional? Again, definitions vary, but for me personally, from what I've seen, a lot of times most people would define it as it's something God has spoken to someone that they're now either doing for themselves or sharing with other people. It's a message, it's a passage, it's a word, it's a vision, it's anything that God's going to build the body up with. And it's going to be for people, glorifying Him. Okay. So you need to establish, are you writing as your personal devo? Or is it a devotional that you're going to give corporately? For this setting, you guys are going to be giving it to people. Okay, it's a corporate devotional. And then what are you trying to accomplish? Are you trying to inspire the people that you're with? Are you trying to challenge them? Or do you want to really encourage them? Do you have that in your mind already when you go to it? That'll change kind of how you look at writing your devotional. If you know the inspiration behind it, if you're trying to elicit something, or if God's really told you, hey, I want you to inspire your students. For me once, it was like, hey, your class is kind of sad. I want you to encourage them before you get up and give a teaching. And I did that. So I spent the first 5-10 minutes of a class lecture in SBS encouraging my students with a devotional, with the word that God had given me for them, because it was time to build them up. They needed it. You know, so having that kind of thing in mind ahead of time is really helpful. As far as the devotional I just gave, I did it for a couple of reasons. Okay? One, pet peeve of mine, I hate when schools forget about their themes. And I, you know, we prayed about it, we got that word. I want to highlight it, and I'm going to highlight it a lot throughout the year, because that's the word we got. Right? So one, directing your attention to something that we've already established, helping shed more light onto it. I asked him if I could use this because I thought it was perfect. Two, I personally felt really challenged by God with walking my daily walk with Him. And I felt like that was a really good word for us corporately. So that's kind of what I was thinking in the back of my mind as I was writing. Any questions? All right, next, let's see if this works, is content, okay? How do you come up with the content of a devo? I'm going to say devo, devotional, interchangeably, sorry about that. But how do you come up with the content? There are so many ways. Here are a few. And then I'm going to give this list, and then think in the back of your mind if you have any others to add, let me know. So, one way is you're living a life in tune with God and your surroundings. Here's the challenging part. A devotional can come to you at any moment, at any time, at any part of your day, and it can be spoken by anybody. You have to be living your life in tune with what God is doing and what the Holy Spirit is speaking. How do you do that? That's something I'm really challenged with, okay? Maybe it's a matter of keeping one of these with you, you know, or a little pouch of something that you can write down really cool words that people get. For example, today Mariska during staff meeting said this really cool quote, and I wrote it down. It says, if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. It was about being with people, and, you know, I loved it. I wrote it down. I could use that some other time, you know, but it's a word that was spoken that I paid attention to that might come up a week later, 2 months later, 3 months later down the road. I might need it. Yesterday, Matt said the word authentic teaching. I loved it. Something inside of me struck, and I was like, I need to write that down because that's the word that I've been searching for what I think we're doing here, you know? So we want to be authentic when we get in front of people. I wasn't the only one who wrote it down. Josh wrote it down. We both did because it struck a nerve inside of us, and it's something that I could then pull into what I was doing. So pay attention to what's happening around you because that can all relate, and it's all about walking with God. I think that's the most important thing. Part of that is your personal Bible study. Okay, confession. SVS grad, I don't do personal Bible studies very often because I'm doing corporate Bible studies so often, you know? But I need to be still personally pursuing my relationship with the Lord and pursuing what He's showing me in the Bible. Because you never know when He's going to speak something. Almost every single time God's told me to memorize a verse of Scripture, I've used it within a week.
Wow.
Almost every single time when people are, you know, praying over another person, I'm like, I have the perfect word for you. But I wouldn't have gotten it had I not been actively seeking that.
That's good.
Next, okay, events. Okay, I can think of two types of events that can help influence your content. What I mean by this is I mean life events, personal events, so anything that's like trials, triumphs, things that have really happened in your life that have changed, like a specific role change. Say you've become a parent. That's huge, and that can show you a lot about the heart of God when it comes to how much He loves you, and you can use that, absolutely. But the key is being aware of what God's showing you on the day to day. Because if you recognize that He's showing you something there, then you're more likely to be able to give that to someone else in a devotional. So personal life events that have happened, awesome. Great tool. Personally, I had this really bad moment in the weight room where I sort of collapsed and couldn't move and had to call the ambulance and it was really awful. But a week later, I gave a devotional to the SBS during our staff training about trusting the Lord and about control issues that I had, and I felt like it was a word for the corporate to remember who's in control of our school. And it was super powerful because it was an event that was so very fresh and it was very stimulating, and everyone knew that the ambulance had come out and had talked to me. You know, it was, yeah, you can use that. Also, current events. You can use current events when you're doing devotionals. What's going on in the world today can have a huge impact on what you're talking about. Say you really feel like God's talking to you about reconciliation or about brotherhood, and you're thinking, oh man, God, what do you want to say about that? And He puts Russia and Ukraine in your mind. You can use what's going on there to talk about an idea that God's placing on your heart. And it's relevant. People are interested. Okay, random sources. And what I mean by this is, like, if you're really living in tune with God, He can speak to you through anything. He can speak to you through a saying on the back of the cereal box. You know, He can speak to you based on something you saw on a license plate, or geographically, the Mariana Trench, you know, the deepest part of the ocean. You can pull a huge devo just from geography if you wanted to, because God speaks in everything. That's the beautiful thing. You just have to be listening. And then content can also come from topics that are assigned to you. So enjoy that, because that's what you get this week.
Seriously?
That's good though. Topics assigned to you are going to be good. Your character of God, maybe it's something that, you know, saying, hey, I want you to look at the character of God. Well, maybe it's a character quality that you've been looking at personally for months in your own life. And now you get to expound on that and talk to people about it. For mine, it's kind of a sign, not really a personally assigned to me, but I really wanted to talk about this passage and the theme of it. And at first, method-wise and how you can do this, I did this, and I probably will never do this again, but it's something I tried. But I took this, be strong, God is with you, and I came up with, I mind mapped it, about like 8 different things that God was showing me about that verse that I could talk about for an hour, easily. And I didn't like that because it was too much content, and I had to zero it in on something that he was specifically really speaking to me. But it's cool because none of that work is going to go to waste. That's going to be our verse for, you know, 6 months. All of those things that he talked to me about can come back up at any point in time, and now I'm ready because I was listening. So, any ideas? Have you guys thought of any other ways that you could get content for a devotional?
Well, under random sources of nature.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of things I've gotten to share with teams have come when I'm like, Lord, I don't know what to say, I don't know what to do, and I'm out somewhere, and he shows me something through, you know, a metaphor, really, in nature.
Sweet.
And I use that.
That's good. Mm-hmm. I like that. Famous quotes?
Yeah, that's
yes.
A good one too.
Those are money.
My football coach in high school was the king of quotes.
Mm-hmm.
And you pull a devotional out of a quote and you want to go climb the biggest, you want to go climb Everest. That's the greatest devotional quote.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I would never underestimate the power of a good quote. Mm-hmm. And placed right at home.
Perfect.
I loved having one in almost every one of my teachers for us, because I love them. They're so good. People are smart, and they've said smart things. And you can use those smart things, and it sounds smart. So do it. Anything else? Can you think of anything else?
Another thing for events
is
events or issues that maybe your audience is going through.
Oh, great.
So
that's
if
awesome.
You know... Like, if you're on outreach, or even if you're at a youth group or wherever you're doing devotional, if you know your audience already, think of the things they might be going through.
Mm-hmm.
And if there's been a recent tragedy or something that they've gone through, make your devotional about a passage that can encourage them through that. Or if you know that they are struggling with something or could be struggling with something, gear your devotional to speak into that issue can be really good too. So knowing your audience, because their issues are often different from what you're going through.
I think knowing your audience is really huge. We could talk about that for days, but really, really huge. I thought of you, each one of those 8 things I thought of when I was mind mapping, I then asked how would it be applicable to you guys? And then how is it applicable to me?
Mm-hmm.
Because it has to be both.
Mm-hmm.
If I can't speak from a passionate place of interest in the topic, I'm not going to be able to deliver it very well, you know. So I was like, okay, what might you be going through? How can I relate to that? Can I relate to that? I mean, sometimes I might not be able to, but I have to be confident in what I speak when I speak it. So knowing people is really important. Yeah.
It's not about the content, it's just I'm reminded of the verse where I've done SBS, I know where it is in the Bible. But like where it talks about, you know, to be ready in season and out of season.
Yeah.
And I for a while, and this is just coming to me now, for a while I always thought of like sharing the gospel, you know, which is true. But even in the devotional setting or in teaching settings, I can see how that verse is right on as well. Because when you're walking your life with God, you're not saying, oh yeah, God, by the way, this is what I'm doing, will you help me out? But when you're living your life in tune with God and the surroundings, that is... For me, that challenges me to, like, that shows me how important it is to be ready in season and out of season. Because you might get, like, for me in housekeeping, I try to do devotions every Monday with them, but I would go along with their week's topic of their lectures so that I could bring in their week's topic with their work duty and try to incorporate
blah, blah,
blah, which is great to put it in the manual. But me having to be even in tune with what God is saying, what God is saying about them, you know, in their settings. I don't know, so I think it kind of brings out that verse a bit more about being ready in season and out of season.
Totally.
Because when you're not when you try to force an emotional, it's not real, it's not authentic.
Yeah, and people can tell.
And they can tell. They can tell. Because you speak in your body language, things are different, I'm sure.
Absolutely. So. Absolutely. And I love that being ready in season, out of season. When it comes to devotionals, and I'm just going to throw this out there as a challenge, you should be ready at any point in time. It's basically being ready for me to come up to you and say, hey, what's God teaching you right now? And you share that. It's basically devotional. You know, so you should be ready. You know? So, okay. The next topic is formatting. How do you format your devotional? I'm really going to need you guys on this one because this is really funny. One source I looked at was like, have a beginning, middle, and end.
That's basic.
Of course you'd have a beginning, middle, and end. The reason I wrote it, the reason I thought it had value and it was worth writing is because I'm going to say this. Please, 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 please have a connection between your beginning, middle, and end.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. If you start one way, know why you started it that way. And if you end one way, know why you ended it that way. And you should be able to see a clear line between them all. Sounds easy. Not always the case. Mm-hmm. You'd think everybody would have that. Not always the case.
Always.
You really, really, really want to have a connection in the flow.
That's fun. That's a fun challenge to have in your verbal processing.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's true. Or if you're a circular thinker.
Or like Vishal, yeah.
Yeah. It's really hard for me sometimes to follow circular thinkers because I'm like, you had a beginning. I thought you had a middle. And you have a beginning, and then I thought you had a middle, but like, where were you going with it? And sometimes it's really hard to flow with them because I want to make connections with what they're saying. Really good circular thinkers can bring it all back around. But sometimes they don't, and they leave you in this kind of spiral, and you're just like, where are you connecting those thoughts? So, yeah, it can be challenging. One thing that will definitely affect your formatting is the style with which you're pulling from, okay? So, different style types would be like this that I just gave to you guys. I had a scripture, so I use a passage, and then I explain what God is saying based on my quiet time with Him. But maybe it's not a passage that you're working from, but maybe it's a word or a picture that God's given you. And that might change or alter or affect a little bit how you format based on you having to describe the word and, you know, maybe the visual or something along those lines, or a life event, you know, maybe that's going to change things up a little bit. Mm-hmm. Can you guys think of any other style formatting? It's really hard. Again, devotionals are so varied.
One thing with style is, because I mean, you look at a devotional, and I mean, the word is devotion, mm-hmm. So usually it's reoccurring. Mm-hmm. That you're going to be having it more than once. And so one thing you want to look at with style is, okay, is it a different topic every week? Or am I trying to carry something through? Like people do book devotionals where you're going through chapters of a book. So that's something to think into. Am I just speaking once to this group of people? Am I speaking with them multiple times? Is there something I'm going to carry through each time? Or is each time going to be something different?
I like that. It's really good. Also, be comfortable in the fact that you might have a style. Okay, I'm an SPS teacher. I admit it. I love passage styles, right? I'm going to do that. I think every single time I've ever heard Ron Smith give a devotional, it goes along those lines. Passage, relevancy to us, maybe church history, relevancy to us, end game. Every single time. He always has a passage. He can always relate it to us. And he generally throws in some church history with it too because he knows it and it's really applicable in that time and it's really applicable to today. Mm-hmm. And he puts us in those shoes. That's Ron's style.
I think a real basic one is highlighting something. So that's a what and how.
Okay.
So, and this actually carries on into your teaching as well. We do a lot of the what, but we kind of forget the how. And the how is the application.
Yeah.
Is how do we challenge them? How do we get them moving out of their seat and doing something? So what and how, that's really basic. And you still need a good introduction, drawing them all in.
Sure.
And you need something to push them out that sends them out. But Yeah, what and how is really basic, but.
And that how would be closely connected to your purpose.
Yes.
Why you're giving that devotional. That's great. Mm-hmm. I love that. Any other thoughts? Formatting? Have you seen any format, like, specifics? I've seen Ron do that so many times that was easy, but mm-hmm. have you seen other people give devotionals and you kind of notice that they have a pattern?
I mean, obviously feedback is important. I mean, that's, you have a beginning, middle, end style, but like, I guess for me, style, my style of doing things is I hear from them where like their feedback after I've already explained what my part is at, what God is showing me, I like to hear back from them.
Yeah.
What God is saying to them already in general, because maybe God was already speaking to them about that topic that we talked about, because if, you know, it's the same God, maybe He's speaking the same thing to lots of people and you're just the one that actually voiced it. So I like to hear back from their feedback from what God's already saying in their lives on that topic or what they heard from what I was sharing. And then from then I can go in and say, you know, devotions aren't super long necessarily, but then I can go in and say, okay, let me, you know, it helps me understand where they are at, and then I can go from there,
mm-hmm.
of what direction they want to take it. Even if it is a devotion and it is shorter, you can still create some teaching.
I like feedback. I really wish we could have had the time because that word, I felt so strongly about it when I was doing it. I was like, man, I really hope this resonates with you guys and I'd love to talk about it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, I just didn't have the time today, but I agree with you. It's nice and it allows the Holy Spirit to like sit.
Mm-hmm.
Some people need to sit with something for a while.
Mm-hmm.
Give them a few minutes. It's not awkward. You know, people can think, you know.
And that's the thing too, is I've noticed like teaching in FCB, it's not awkward to have silence. Because what one of my biggest pet peeves, and I'm probably guilty of this, is when they ask a question, and for the introverts and those that need time to think about it, God is speaking, they're quick to rush to fill in the answers or to say something else to fill in that gap. And for me, I like to just sit there quietly and think about it.
Mm-hmm.
But then you have to gauge, are they actually participating or are they in la la land or what? But yeah.
If the whole class is silent, it forces them to think about it. They think about something else, but.
Yeah.
You'd like to think through that. Alright, anything else on this? No? Okay. So our last two are the do's and don'ts of devos. And I've said a few of them. I'm really going to stress a few of them because it's important. But the do's are pretty simple. One, pray. It makes zero sense to not to pray when you're writing a devotional.
Mm-hmm.
It is all about glorifying God. It's all about bringing His word, His message. If you do not pray, you do not have the Holy Spirit, like I said earlier, it's just dead words. And people know it. It's inauthentic. Next, try to make one point really well.
Mm-hmm.
Devotionals aren't super long. So you don't have time. I didn't have time in this to, you know, really explore the depths of Joshua and all of those areas. And I had 8 points that I would have loved to talk about, but I can't. So try to make one point. Now, maybe your one point, you have to surface level a lot of different topics because you're showing them a theme or a big idea or a big concept. Fine, but the concept's not those little points. It's the theme, right? So you're making one point. Next, be passionate. I am a passionate person, but I strongly believe that passion is contagious.
Mm-hmm.
And that if you are in front of people and you're talking about the Word of God, live it, believe it, think it, live it, live it, live it, be passionate. Because it's contagious. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
You have to believe what you're saying, or it's dead. Super important. I had a speaker at my DTS who was talking about passion. He was just telling people to be passionate. He's like, I'm just a passionate person. So he was Mormon, and then he became a Christian. And when he was a Mormon, he said he sat next to some lady on a bus for a certain number of hours, and because he was so passionate about Mormonism, she converted to Mormonism while he was on the bus. And he's like, I had to write her years later and like try to explain Christianity. But not the point. But the point is it's contagious in all of its forms. Be passionate about what you're saying. I loved that story. And I hope it worked out for her.
Yeah.
Okay, here's a good one. stick to your allotted time limit. Please stick to your allotted, know your allotted time limit. Ask somebody. I mean, I'm big on allowing the Holy Spirit to move, and sometimes that takes longer than you think. However, you've got to think about these things when you're doing them. If I'm giving a devotional in a staff meeting, I go over by 10 or 15 minutes. I'm either cutting someone else's 10 or 15 minute time, or I'm going to have the entire staff stay in that room for an extra 10 or 15 minutes, which makes them late for all of their schools, for all of their appointments, meetings. Everything gets pushed back for an entire day, and it's because I just took extra time. That's disrespectful. It's disrespectful for the person who's asked you to give a devo, and it's disrespectful for the people that are around you. And to be perfectly frank, when people go over time limits on anything, whether it's a teaching or a devotional or anything, I stop listening. Mm-hmm. In my SBS, when it became snack time, and a teacher would like go over by 20, 30 minutes, I stopped listening, and I started getting angry. And the longer it went on, the more angry I got, because you gotta respect our time. That's something we, you know is coming. It sounds silly. Huge deal, though. Know your time.
Especially when you need to clean up.
Yeah, especially when you need to clean up. Yeah, exactly. And use your time wisely. Okay, you don't have heaps of time, so use it wisely. Do not go back into the history of Joshua and explain, you know, the entire Pentateuch leading up to it if you've got 10, 15 minutes. They don't need to know that. They need to know he's going to the promised land. That's it. Okay? You need to move on. So know your time limits, stick to them, and then cut extraneous stuff out. You don't need it. You're just delivering a word. Give what you need and then move on.
Amen.
You have a question?
No, question.
Okay. Any other do's that you can think of? I've got a few don'ts, but do you have any other do's that you can think of off the top of your head?
Do the application you challenge them to do.
Yes.
I have been convicted so terribly.
Preferably before you even give it.
Yes. Much preferably before you give it.
Yeah. Absolutely. You cannot get in front of people and tell them to do something that you're not willing to do yourself. It's not authentic. No. Yeah, and they know. Especially in an environment like this where we live and we breathe and we eat with these people all the time. They see you in your daily interactions. If you say that you're like something and they know that you're not because they've watched you walk out your life, they know it. I happen to know you guys all really well. If you say that you do something that you don't, I'm gonna know it, okay? You gotta walk it out.
Oh boy.
No. It's true. It's true. I love that. Great point. And it has a lot of weight to it if you've already done the application.
Yeah.
It adds a lot. Because it shows them that it's doable and that it had an impact on you. Okay, don'ts. Here are the few don'ts I have. Don't make apologies or think what you're saying is silly. When you're giving a devotional, it's really hard. Sometimes you get a word from God and you're like, this word I got from God was about pistachio ice cream. And I really don't know what that meant, but then I started thinking about it, and then you have this like great word, but you want to apologize for it because it had something to do with pistachio ice cream and you didn't see how that could possibly be important. Don't make excuses. God speaks to us in crazy ways. We've already established that. Don't think it's silly, because a lot of times when you have questions, what sounds silly isn't silly to other people. They have the same question, they're just not willing to, you know, speak it out. Okay, this is a presenting don't, which I know we're going to talk about, but because I feel so strongly about it, I put it in here. But when presenting, don't read word for word. That's just being in front of people. You can write it out word for word, your devotional, and if you really need to, please do that, especially if you guys do them for Friday. If you have to, that's really helpful for people. Write it out. But when you present it, know it. Maybe highlight it, maybe color code it, maybe pull out a few of those words, get an outline format of it, but you don't want to be looking down the whole time because then your audience isn't connected to you. And you're going to feel it more if you know it better. Make eye contact. Don't be rude. Very important. And last one, never minimize the impact that you may be having by what you're saying. Never think that it's not important. You don't know what people are thinking. I might be able to think I can read what you guys are thinking right now, but I don't know. No, Stephen, no, I have no idea. And so don't minimize what the Spirit could be speaking to other people. Allow Him to move. Okay. Any other do's and don'ts? Steve.
I have a don't.
Okay.
This isn't just for Devo, it's also for when you go up and say a word like I was saying. Don't say that you don't want to share it.
Yeah.
So I don't want to share this.
I don't
want to be up here.
Or the typical, no one knows how to open, so they always open with, you know, when your chest is pounding and your breathing is really
scary. You don't
need
an introduction, just going.
It's so much nicer. Well, even if
they
had a good introduction, it's just the go-to, and you want to have an introduction, so they say that. They just don't know not to. Yeah, Jack and Bollinger tried to rip those waving people strongly.
Really?
She strongly said, don't do them. She was, were you there?
I think there's times where it's fitting. I don't mind. But like, to saying, I don't want to be up here or I'm really nervous.
That's not an extra one, but for me, the first one, don't make apologies or think your idea is silly. That's a huge one that I still deal with. I've gotten a lot better, I think, at it. But because of insecurities that I've had, or have, sometimes I feel like what I have to say doesn't actually make a difference or it will matter.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm getting to the point where it does make a difference and it does matter, and I just need to be confident in that. And I think if I'm feeling that way, I'm sure many other people are as well, because, you know, I think so. That's an important one for me personally. That's really important to remember.
Totally.
Because if I'm really truly hearing what God is saying, and spending time with God and walking with Him, then what I have to say is valid, and it does not need an apology.
Yeah.
Because it's coming from what God is saying in my walk with Him.
Absolutely. And you know what? If you're living a life in tune with God and He's speaking something to you continually, you're going to have that confidence. Because you know when you get up in front of someone.
Mm-hmm.
He's been talking to me about this here. I'm pretty positive that what He's saying is true.
Yeah.
You know? And I'll listen.
I think one thing with devotionals is often your role changes in the midst of them, where when you're teaching or preaching, your whole point is you're giving a lecture and giving an application. But in a devotion, usually you're sharing a topic, preferably for a less significant portion of the time, and then your role changes often to a facilitator, and you end up facilitating discussions.
Mm-hmm.
Not aiming to dominate the discussion, and I don't, well, something, I, well, no, let me forget that. But you often, you'll transition from being the person who's presenting the devotion to somebody facilitating discussion. So asking questions, because often when you can stir people to think and come up with things for themselves, that's when they learn the most and have the most growth. And then usually at the end, facilitating out of that to somebody bringing application. But just notice, just remembering that in a devotional, it should be, most often they're pretty interactive, and your role in a devotional can change. So
I love that. That goes along with what you hope to have, is that time of, you know, thinking about it, processing feedback.
Mm-hmm.
Then the facilitator will come in handy. It's awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Any other thoughts?
I don't think we do, like, I think we usually have 40 staff members or something, and they all get together in the morning, and you have, like, a 5-minute devotion, and someone gets up and shares, but there's no time to facilitate it, and it's just one person talking, and I feel like I've never seen that actually have, like, a growth in the staff, but I feel like, as you were speaking, I was thinking, that could change it dramatically, because then they actually, it could be a smaller event, so I was just thinking, I like that.
Good. Okay.